Today I want to talk about D'Wan Mathis, and it seems he is done playing at Georgia. And all that's coming up after the bumper.
Don't be cornering me. Hold up. Time. You gotta help me with that corner sh**.
What's up, kinfolk? It's RJ Young. I am not on a step mill. Consider hitting the like and subscribe button because I upload a video every single day. So it's college football related, sports related. We have a good time. Today, I want to talk about D'Wan Mathis, who has apparently left the team and does not look like he's going to return. This according to Dawgs 247 that had the scoop on D'Wan Mathis not being with the team ahead of their game against South Carolina. This comes just a week after JT Daniels assumed the starting position and really had the best performance of any quarterback with a Georgia uniform on all year against Mississippi State. Threw for over 400 yards and became the first Georgia quarterback to do so since Aaron Murray in 2013. JT Daniels was a hot commodity coming out of high school. Many of you know this coming out of modern day where the Monarchs were just destroying people, played for national championships, won a national championship, had 67 touchdown passes as a high school football player, and thinking like just ridiculous amounts of recruiting led him to USC. Now, USC is right there in his back pocket. At the time, it looked like he was going to be joined by Brew McCoy, and they were going to light the world on fire, former Matter Day teammate. He played a little while, didn't go so well, blew out his ACL, lost his job to Keaton Slovis. Instead of staying at SC to compete for that job this year, he chose to enter the transfer portal and came out at Georgia, right as Todd Monken felt like he was going to have one of the best quarterback rooms in America. Because at the time, he has Jamie Newman as a grad transfer from Wake Forest. Adding to that, yes, JT Daniels, and then D'Wan Mathis, who's coming off of quite literally brain surgery and looks healthy to play. And then Stetson Bennett coming from a JUCO program after first walking on at Georgia. And when Stetson Bennett got the opportunity to usurp D'Wan Mathis, that felt like the end of it because D'Wan Mathis actually got the start for the season. 6'6", 205 pounds. He wasn't as highly recruited as some, but what D'Wan Mathis represents to me is another turning page and chapter in the Justin Fields saga, because after Fields did not get an opportunity to basically win that job at Georgia and never started as a freshman at Georgia, sitting the bench behind Jake Fromm, still don't understand that, he decided to go into the transfer portal, and he came out at Ohio State. Now, this at a time when the portal is not really in existence. You got to get a waiver to play. Remember? Like, that's a big part of this. D'Wan Mathis hears about this after having committed to Ohio State in June 2018 and then decides right before signing period he's going to flip his commitment to Georgia. And he walks over there as a big, strong athlete and perhaps an answer to this question of whether or not Kirby Smart's going to put in there a dual threat quarterback, the kind of guy that can make it happen with his legs as well as his arm. Now, D'Wan Mathis is not Justin Fields. We have data to show that now in this 2020 season. But I also think that this is in keeping with how things are going to go for Georgia, not just this year, but in the years to come, because they have something of a quarterback logjam, even as D'Wan Mathis seems to be exiting the program. You have Carson Beck right there on your roster. That's a guy that many of us believed could play as a true freshman if it came to that. And while we were all befuddled by why JT Daniels was not playing, we were even more befuddled by why we weren't seeing any of Carson Beck. Add to that, you have a Brock Vandergriff who is committed to play at Georgia in the 2021 class. So it's not as if Kirby Smart's running out of quarterbacks, but when he settles on a guy, he wants to settle on a guy. That's one of the reasons he rode with Stetson Bennett for so long, even as we know he does not have the tools to be a high major Power 5 quarterback, especially the kind that can beat an Alabama or beat a Florida, because that's where Georgia is right now. They feel like a quarterback away when they should never be a quarterback away because of the way they've been recruiting. And there's so much to be said about the recruiting that is going on at Georgia that we're all looking at them as the number 9 team in the country and going, how? It's because you have tremendous respect for the roster. They've won 2 out of the last 3 recruiting national championships, which is to say They have finished number one among ranked recruiting classes two out of the last 3 years. They get to say, we don't actually need Zach Evans. We have Zamir White. We have James Cook. We have Kendall Milton. We have Dejan Edwards. At wideout, George Pickens now has a running mate in Kyaris Jackson, a dude that can actually carry that wide receiver load for you if there is no George Pickens. And now we got Deonte Burton coming on. And then there was so much to be said about what Demetrius Robertson could or could not do. Add that to what Kirby Smart's defense had been. We'll see if it was just Will Rogers in Mississippi State and Kyle Trask at Florida. But it feels like there are some fissures that are growing into Kirby Smart and Dan Shulman's defense. Now, I don't think it's going to be that big a deal, especially as they get to beat up on a South Carolina team that not a whole lot of people respect, not the least of which is South Carolina, as they fired their head coach midway through the season, okay? But I think that this is also an opportunity for JT Daniels to make Todd Monken and Kirby Smart look even better. Now, does Kirby Smart want to try to lure D'Wan Mathis back in? Probably. You want to have as many quarterbacks on the roster as you possibly can, especially guys you think you can roll out there given the circumstances. And in the corona season, you need as many warm bodies as you could possibly put on a football field. But I find it be really interesting that D'Wan Mathis has given up on his tenure at Georgia, if for no other reason than I always thought he could work himself back into it because they just don't have another athlete on that football team at that position like him, right? That said, it seems like it's going to be JT Daniels' job for the foreseeable future. If you don't think you can beat that dude out, by all means, go into the portal, come out at a place where you think you can play. That's going to be the question for me is, where does D'Wan Mathis end up? Who needs a quarterback and who needs really a project at quarterback? A guy that still needs to learn how to play the game at this level, how to assess what he sees in front of him, read the defense, because his physicality and his athletic ability are always going to keep you in a ball game. If you can teach him to read the field, to read coverages, to run through his progressions, and to run the offense, he's going to be outstanding. Outstanding. He's just going to need some coaching up. So perhaps there's a quarterback whisperer out there that might be able to do something with him. And I think that there is, right? I'm just not sure that there is one in the Power Five. We're going to find out, right? There's a lot of places that need a quarterback, like, say, Kentucky. They could do with a dude that could throw the ball, but as much as Terry Wilson has not been the guy for Kentucky, Joey Gatewood wasn't the guy for Kentucky, and Mark Stoops needs a quarterback. We'll see how this goes. I'm interested to see how all of this falls into place, but news is D'Wan Mathis seems to be on his way out. Kirby Smart seems to have settled on his starting quarterback. All right, that is it for me. Deuces. Oh, yeah, it is Will Smith's Bel Air Academy jersey, because, yeah, I got it like that.